Good afternoon. I'd like to welcome you all to IWP for our talk from Dr. Lamont Colucci entitled Grand Strategy, National Security Doctrines and National Security Strategy, Past, Present, and Future. Dr. Lamont Colucci has experience as a diplomat with the U.S. Department of State and is today an associate professor and chairman of politics and government at Ripon College. His primary area of expertise is U.S. national security and U.S. foreign policy. At Ripon, he's the coordinator of the National Security Studies Program and teaches courses on national security, foreign policy, intelligence, terrorism, and international relations. He's an excellent professor. I speak from experience. He's published a book entitled Crusading Realism, The Bush Doctrine and American Core Values After 9/11, and was a contributing author to another book entitled The Day That Changed Everything, Looking at the Impact of 9/11 and the End of a Decade. In 2012, he finished two-volume series entitled The National Security Doctrines of American Presidency, How They Shape and Present Shape Our Present and Future. In 2012, he became the Fulbright Scholar in Residence at the Diplomatic Academy in Vienna, Austria. He has an undergraduate and graduate degrees from the University of Wisconsin-Madison and a doctorate in politics from the University of London in England. In 2007, he was the recipient of Ripon Severy Excellence in Teaching Award, and in 2010, the Underkofler Outstanding Teaching Award. In 2015, he received the National Significant Sig Award from Sigma Chi Fraternity. Dr. Colucci is also an occasional columnist for the Washington Times, National Review, Weekly Standard, and Defense News. He's a weekly columnist for the U.S. News and World Report. He is also a senior fellow at the National Security in National Security Affairs for the American Foreign Policy Council, and is an advisor in National Security and Foreign Affairs to the NATO-based Conference of Defense Associations Institute. He served as founding interim director for the Center of Politics at Ripon. And you can find more out about him at lamontcolucci.com, or you can ask me or Brad. We both had him as a professor. I'm super excited to listen to him speak again. So here we go.
Thank you very much for having me today. It's great to be at IWP. There's a bit of a special relationship between Ripon College and IWP, in that when I inaugurated our National Security Studies program, I sent out a call to all the major graduate schools that deal with national security issues. And a few of them responded by sending a case of literature or a package of books or pamphlets. IWP says, well, can we come out? And at that time, your student recruiter, the person in charge of, I think, student recruitment, plus Professor DeGaffenried came out and inaugurated the program with Jim Woolsey, the former CIA director. So since that time, I've funneled a number of students who are undergraduates at Ripon to IWP. And so there's a bit of an interesting relationship since I came on board at Ripon and we inaugurated the National Security Studies program. The other funny thing I'm reminded of is Lacey and I seem to be trading podiums. The last time that we saw each other, I was one introducing her as the alumni award recipient for that year, and then she came up and spoke. So we keep doing this. We'll have to see what happens. Today, I want to speak a little bit about national security doctrines, grand strategy, and what that all means. We're entering a very contentious presidential cycle where I hope that at least the issue of national security and foreign affairs becomes prevalent. Regardless of which candidate you prefer, I found it very disheartening the last two cycles that national security issues in general and even foreign policy issues seem to be essentially ignored. The bad news, I think, is that, in my opinion, our field, and therefore policy too, has been hijacked by the issue of terrorism and counterterrorism. That is not to suggest that these are not pivotal or important issues that need to be dealt with. But one of the reasons I ended up writing the book, the two volumes, I should say, in 2012, was because I saw it as an incredible problem that we had taken a normal ladder, where at the top of the ladder, national security strategy, grand strategy, national security policy, all the way down to operations and tactics, and flipped it over. That we get very obsessed with issues of counterterrorism to the point where we spend an inordinate amount of time talking about a single weapons platform, drones, and single attacks against selected terrorists. And that seems to end the discussion. And at no point does anybody even force our presidential candidates, although again, I hope this changes, to address where do you see the United States in 5, 10, 50, 500 years? And how do you ensure that the United States is in the position that it is today in 5, 10, 50, 100, or 500 years? And I realize that you have to translate that into the electorate, but I think that can be done, by the way. I do not think that is a, I think that is an easy problem to solve. It is not a difficult problem to take that and translate that into electoral politics for the average voter, not for so-called elites only. So that began a concept in my mind of how do we address this issue of grand strategy? And my answer was that in US history, we address that issue with national security doctrines. So okay, if that's true, if we take that premise, then how many presidents succeeded at having one? And I used a series of tests that developed into litmus tests, 16. There were 16 presidents from George Washington to Barack Obama that met the standards of having a doctrine. Now, the word doctrine comes from the Latin doctrina, which means teaching or instruction. But the actual connotation of that is a set of principles that guide, overarching principles that have more to do than any single policy could ever illustrate. And so when I looked at the presidents that had successful doctrines, I noticed that there were 9 variables, and I'm not going to go into each variable. If you have an interest during question time, I'd be happy to investigate with you any of them. But very briefly, there are American exceptionalism and the manifest destiny, the empire of liberty, free trade, unilateralism, the American way of war, internationalism, geography and geopolitics, and military primacy. So these effective doctrines outlast any president. They outlast most anybody's single life. Many of them still we live with today, including the first one. And they have direct meaning not only on the present, but more importantly on the future. So let me briefly discuss a few of them in the past. And then if audiences are typical, they want to spend most of the time on George W. Bush and Barack Obama. And so I will do that. And if there is an interest in going back and you want to talk about somebody that I couldn't mention today, like James Polk or somebody like that, we can do that. My publisher, Prager, I pitched this idea at the International Security Conference, and that year was in Monterey. And it was one of those meetings that was unplanned by both parties, and it was over a reception. And I said, "Oh, it would be interesting to write a book on this." He said, "Yeah, send me your idea." And within a week, I had a yes. But they were very surprised at the inclusion of a couple of presidents that don't normally get talked about in terms of either grand strategy or national security doctrines. And the first one was Washington. Now, we talk about Washington endlessly, but we talk about him in very different terms than what I'm talking about. We mythologize him, and like Abraham Lincoln, I actually think the mythologizing of Washington and Lincoln is less than the reality. That by creating the mythology, we actually don't fully grasp how incredible these presidents really were, not just in this area, but in many other areas. And of course, it's Washington that sets the first grand strategic tone for American foreign policy. The term, of course, national security, as many of you know, does not even get used until the Second World War, but that doesn't mean the concepts weren't very well known and well used. And so what was the Washington Doctrine, and why is it so important for us today? And I think it is pivotal because Washington faces this unbelievable question. How do I interpret the new Constitution in the realm of national security? Of course, he would have never used that language, as I've said, but in the concept, how do I interpret this? Where do we go from here? And so, as many of you may know from history, there were initial struggles of the Washington administration, especially in the first term. The second term got more difficult for Washington, but especially in the first term, about who really makes foreign affairs and what we today call national security. And Washington attempted to bring in the Congress, even in ways today that we would not consider perhaps even appropriate, and Congress proved in the 18th century to be more dysfunctional than today in their inability to deal with the security crises, primarily of the French Empire, the British Empire, the Spanish Empire, and the Indian tribes. And so it became quickly necessary for Washington to establish the first and most lasting aspect of his legacy, and that is presidential supremacy in foreign affairs. And so we take it for granted today that Article II sort of spells that out, but it wasn't ever put into practice until Washington must put it to practice. He also determines the first tenor of alliances. And within that concept of alliances, recognition. Americans, I think, take it for granted that in the United States, we actually think that granting diplomatic recognition goes beyond an analysis of whether or not a government controls a certain area, has a capital, a currency, law enforcement, law, legal system, and all of that, but that there is a moral aspect to recognition. And Washington sets the tone for that when he initially refuses to recognize the new government in France, even though the Anti-Federalists and many members of Congress are extraordinarily angry at him for that. And so immediately Washington brings into the debate, and we talk about it with Cuba as I speak today, should the United States grant recognition only on the basis of some cold, calculated analysis of whether or not that government exists? Or is there something more? Well, that something more goes all the way back to the first administration. And so when I speak a lot and I deal a lot with people, especially in Europe, they ask me, why are you Americans so moralistic when it comes to this? It goes into the very first presidency and onward. He also establishes armed neutrality and free navigation of the seas. And so when we look fast forward to President Carter, who has to learn a very difficult lesson in his first few years in office, that he cannot utilize perhaps some of his assumptions that he made prior, that with the Soviet invasion of Afghanistan and the Iranian Revolution, he is forced to issue the Carter Doctrine, which is that the Persian Gulf and its waterways are in the American national interest. Many people said, how can you Americans believe that opening a waterway is somehow your right? But that right that we have established goes all the way back to the declarations, again, of the first president. And so if there's ever a foreign policy that has a lasting impact on us, the free navigation of the seas would definitely be that. So again, it's that how do I take the Constitution as a national security document, which is Washington's burden, and he answers it in very clear tones. Probably the second one is the one that everybody writes about is Monroe. And so everybody talks about James Monroe, and most people would argue that it was actually he who had that first grand strategy doctrine, non-colonization, non-intervention, non-interference, non-transfer, and even expansionism. And so I won't spend too much time more than that, that obviously I recognize that situation. The third one I'll briefly mention, and was the most shocking for the publisher, was Lincoln. We think of Lincoln as the great wartime leader and the great emancipator. Again, the mythology is less than the reality, in my opinion, with Abraham Lincoln, but we rarely talk about him in the sense of national security, except in the general idea that he saved the Union. But in fact, it is the Lincoln administration that establishes every precedent that would be used by Wilson, FDR, and George W. Bush. You cannot discuss what George W. Bush did in relation to battlefield detainees and enemy combatants unless we first understand that it was Lincoln who created all of those terms, at least in its content sense, not, of course, in linguistic sense. Because it's Lincoln that suspends habeas corpus when he needs to. It's Lincoln that has to deal with this creature that is neither soldier and neither criminal and not a civilian. And indefinite detention and what today we refer to as enemy combatants and battlefield detainees are established in order to save the Union by Lincoln. And Lincoln's justification that the Constitution, to use Jackson's phrase, Justice Jackson's phrase, the Constitution is not a suicide pact, is therefore utilized by Wilson in the First World War, Franklin Delano Roosevelt in the Second World War, and George W. Bush in the War on Terror. Theodore Roosevelt. Theodore Roosevelt is interesting on so many levels. I mention him in the grand strategy sense because it is Roosevelt for the first time as an American president that interprets American national security from an international perspective. And he talks about that the only way for America to secure its security is through both engaging in civilizing and in stabilizing. And they cannot be divorced from each other. That, in essence, to say that one is liberal and one is realist is a false premise. That in order to gain the stability, you have to engage in the civilizing. And in order to gain the civilizing, you have to engage in the stability. And although we probably would not use the term that he used today, civilizing, the content and the sentiment is still the same. Naturally, we could not forego mentioning Woodrow Wilson, the victory of American liberalism in the international relations sense, and his bringing to the fore issues of human rights, democracy, and issues that promote civic society. Harry Truman almost deserves a volume unto himself. It would be impossible to look at today's national security environment and everything that surrounds this building, whether it's State Department, say, Pentagon, without credit to one president and one president alone, and that's Harry Truman. Whether we're talking about the 1947 National Security Act or the whole concept of national security, not just in a sense of policy, but for all of you here in the sense of studying it, it really comes to the fore with the decisions that Harry Truman made, seeing, unfortunately, some of the disastrous decisions by the FDR administration vis-a-vis the Soviet Union. And it is Truman's recognition that going back to the old style of national security would not work. You could not demobilize your national security apparatus or your military and expect to, at a very minimum, survive the Cold War, let alone try to win it. Ronald Reagan, of course, gives us a rebirth to military primacy, something that would be on the fore for many of the past presidents as necessary. And it's linked to an American way of war, which, as a side note, I think we have forgotten in many ways that there is an American way of war, and it almost usually guarantees victory. I can talk about that if you'd like in greater detail later. But it is Reagan that recognizes that in order to deal with the Cold War, you have to win it. In order to win it, you have to have superiority. Well, as is usually the case, people like to spend the majority of time on the contemporary period, which I will define as the Bush and Obama years. George W. Bush, I don't know what this town thinks of him these days, nor do I care. He will go down as one of the greatest presidents that ever occupied the White House. Whether I'm the only person in this room that wants to agree with that, I'm also fine with that. I'm used to hostile crowds. I come from Madison, Wisconsin. It will take some time, and it will be similar to the Truman phenomenon. What was he trying to do in grand strategy, though? And there, I think, lies the pathway to why I say what I said. Bush faces an incredible problem on so many levels, and we make it cosmetic in the sense that we focus on a singular day, right? The 9/11 attacks. But that attack has so much impact because of the deepness of the conflict. And so when people say, well, what was this Bush doctrine? What was it about? And there's all these labels, you know, and the laziest label I find, and this usually will get me into trouble with some more people, the laziest label is a neoconservative. I don't know what the hell a neoconservative is. I know that if I lined up 10 neoconservatives in the room, or at least people who others have labeled neoconservative, 5 will leave in disgust that I called them that. The other 5 will kill each other over what it really means. I don't think that makes for a very cohesive philosophy. The old joke that a British scholar once said about Tony Blair and George W. Bush, because they're neoconservatives, and he said, well, you know, there's not a hell of a lot neo about George, and there's definitely not a lot of con about Tony, so I'm not sure what that really means. And I think there's some value in that that joke. I made a list once of everything that was attempted, every label that they attempted to use regarding George W. Bush. Anti-moral relativists, American exceptionalists, democratic globalists, democratic realists, right-wing Wilsonians, hardline conservative, Wilsonian Reaganites, freedom agenda advocates, and the list goes on. I wrote a book called Crusading Realism, and so that's the right title. That's the one I'll be using. Crusading realism, as I defined it, was what Bush was trying to do. He was trying to say that there is a moral cowardice to a certain degree in liberalism, international relations liberalism, that it's wonderful to talk about human rights and human dignity and democracy and civil society and the rule of law, but if you're unwilling to actually use tools of force, if you have to make sure that that happens, then you may actually make a situation far worse. You may make that worse than it was prior to any kind of intervention. On the other hand, there was a bankruptcy to some of the realism that was out there in that you can coldly calculate so-called national and vital interests, but at the end of the day, that may only give you a period of time of stability, and it may not last longer than a generation or two. And so is there a pathway, the Bush people asked, is there a pathway of utilizing what could be called realist tools for so-called liberal desires? And I think that's what became the Bush Doctrine. And I say it rested on four pillars: preemption, prevention, primacy, and democracy promotion. Preemption, prevention, primacy, and democracy promotion. Some of them are less interesting than others. Preemption is nothing new. It is in antiquity and will always be used by any state. If a state sees an immediate threat before that threat hits, I will take action. And everybody knows that every state would do that if it had the ability to do that. I think the unusual aspect with the Bush people is that they announced it. They made it public. And that was not quite cricket for much of the diplomatic community. A little more controversial was prevention. I'm not going to wait for the threat to be right on my doorstep. It's on the horizon. And in order for me not to be in that crisis mode, a time of preemption, I'm going to act now. And that gets a little few people have left, you know, that room with that announcement. Military primacy is spelled out very clearly in the national security strategy. The United States will not tolerate a peer competitor. And what that essentially means is the United States will not tolerate any single country or rational possible coalition to threaten American military primacy. And of course, that has real costs. It has pragmatic results and a pragmatic cost, not least of which, is the defense budget. The most interesting one for me, I suppose, is the last pillar, and that's democracy promotion. But it's very fascinating that even the Bush people allowed the American and international media to hijack the term by saying, oh, I see what you want. You want to have elections, and then you want to go home. And at no point did the Bush people advocate that. The Bush people from the very beginning understood that in order for democracy to be assisted somewhere, not installed, but in order for it to grow, you would have to adapt. And if it's Iraq, it has to be Muslim, it has to be Arab, and it has to bring in the seeds of Iraqi culture. And so having an election will never work. And so when you talk about this idea of democracy promotion from the people who really advocate it, I don't know anyone in that group that says, let's go out, have an election, and call it a day. But we have allowed both the international and the national media to suggest that that's what it means. And of course, you know, the joke is kind of about Hamas, one man, one vote, one time, and call that an election. So everything has been made, everything I would argue regarding the Bush years has been made into a cartoon, a caricature. And I think even the Republican Party is scared of talking about it in positive terms because the caricature seems to dominate electoral politics. I'm happy to talk a little bit more about prevention and primacy if you would like, but I think I'll shift over to President Obama and then open it up for questions and people can go on whatever tangents they would actually prefer. When President Obama came into office, I was asked to write a piece for the Washington Times on whether or not there was an Obama doctrine. And I knew I'd be thinking about this because I had just finished up the book on the Bush doctrine. And so, you know, you have to give it some time. You know, what is the campaign that he's running equivalent to the way he's going to govern and all of that stuff. And so let's refresh our memory a little bit. So he said when he was running for president, I want to get out of Iraq and onto the, quote, right battlefield of Afghanistan and Pakistan. And he said he'd want to develop the capabilities and partnerships to take out terrorists and the most deadly weapons. He wants to engage the world to dry up terror and extremism. And the fourth, and perhaps again the most interesting one, to restore our values. By implication, President Bush had destroyed our values. And so as 2008 and 9 transitioned into 10, 11, and 12, the question became, was there a grand strategy that the Obama administration was following? And what is it? And there were three schools of thought during the first term. And the first school was ABB, anything but Bush. There was no talk of preemption. There was no talk of prevention. There was no talk of democracy promotion. There were no grand pledges to eradicate tyranny. It seemed like, you know, the Bush people wanted X, well, we're going to go with Y. And that was one school of thought. And the second school of thought said, well, there is no doctrine. And that school broke up into two very vicious camps regarding each other. The first camp said, there's no doctrine because he doesn't want one. He actively is against the whole concept of following grand strategy. He's actually against a concept of a doctrine because he wants to be nimble and agile and quick. He's going to tack this way and tack that way. And the second group that said there's no doctrine because he just doesn't get it. He doesn't understand grand strategy. He doesn't understand national security policy. He simply doesn't understand it. Then there was a third school of thought out there that said, you know what, it's all somewhat humorous and maybe interesting, but it's false. There is actually a doctrine. And people began to adapt various slogans to describe it. Leading from behind probably wins the lottery on most used phrase. I think I use something called managing the decline. And I will be honest with my bias, I am of the third school. I thought that there was an agenda from day one. I think there is a belief in a strategy. And it actually, in my opinion, encapsulates a number of past presidents Paul put into one. What is the strategy? Well, I think it is greater authority of international organizations and kind of worshiping at the altar of multilateralism for multilateralism's sake. It almost doesn't matter the issue. As long as the United States never appears to act unilaterally, which is a false game to begin with. The United States never acts unilaterally to begin with. But again, the media can hijack that and say, Bush acted unilaterally. And he never did, but it's good for selling newspapers. But there's this idea that if an international institution such as, but not only the UN, grants us some authority, then we're good, otherwise we're not. There's a definite belief that nuclear weapons are inherently evil and that the only way to deal with it is disarmament. And we know the goal is zero, but you can say, well, that's never going to happen. You might be right, but what may happen under a President Obama, given the chance, is a reduction to arsenal levels that are dangerous, that at least put in a question about whether deterrence is truly viable. And I'm not going to sit around and discuss necessarily, unless you really want to, throw weights and how many warheads and MIRVs and potential MARVs, and we can do that if you want. But the real question is, what is the real level of deterrence, and isn't it better to ensure that there is no doubt? Isn't that the whole concept behind the best forms of deterrence strategy? The third aspect of the strategy, I would argue, is kind of a penance and contrition for what is perceived as past abuses or past crimes. Many people point to the Strasbourg speech and other, and the first UN speech. A primacy of negotiation for negotiation's sake. I would argue that was the Iran deal. That what seemed to happen, and my old employer, the State Department, is the most guilty of this, and one of the reasons I was the most uncomfortable when I was a Foreign Service officer, is that the deal was the goal, as opposed to the goal was the goal. Meaning if the goal is what is in the best interest of the United States, what promotes our national interests, and more importantly, our vital interests, and I'll pursue that. Or is it, I'm so invested in making a negotiation successful that the deal in and of itself becomes the goal. That, I think, is the Obama administration writ large when it comes to international relations. We all know that there is an allergy to the use of the term, no war on terror. You know, we know that there were all these euphemisms that they tried out. Luckily, both even the media and the use of the English language prevented some of these from being permanent, right? Man-caused disasters, overseas contingency operations. And they've never, to my knowledge, if you know the answer to this, you can share it with me, I have never heard that they have a replacement for enemy combatants. I know they don't like to use the term, so I don't know what they say. People in Gitmo, I don't know. And finally, I think the strategy, and I've saved the best for last, and it is probably illustrated by those people who adopted the leading from behind mantra, is we need to play a more restricted role. And whether we look at certain inactions in Ukraine, what I consider total implosion over Syria, a bizarre alienation of the British and the Israelis, a unbelievable, I don't know what to call, mess of Libya, it seems like it's a constant, we need to pull back. We don't have something to fill that gap. We're going to pull back. We want to create more room for others, maybe coalitions or allies in an amorphous sense. But if they don't materialize, then that's somehow acceptable. And so I would argue, therefore, that if you kind of cobble together Jimmy Carter, Richard Nixon, and Bill Clinton, you get the Obama Doctrine. And I would say the worst aspects of Nixon, the worst aspects of Clinton, well, that's everything, and the worst aspects of Carter, which is mostly everything, you get the Obama Doctrine. And so I do not subscribe to the school that says there is no strategy because he doesn't get it. I remember I invited Dinesh D'Souza to speak at my home college, and that went over well by some. But and I remember him saying something, this is just a few weeks ago, and I liked it. He says, you know, all of these conservatives and all of these people, these realists and conservative internationalists, and if you want to call them democratic realists, and you cobble them all together, they keep saying, hey, President Obama, you don't get it. I'll tell you, this is what's really Putin's up to. Hey, President Obama, here's what's going on in Syria. And it's this assumption that if he just got it, right, then he would take swift action to correct it. But as D'Souza said, and I don't want to steal from him, that's why I'm giving him credit here, where is there evidence for this? He obviously is a smart and intelligent person. So after all these years, if someone keeps, many, many people and very high-level former foreign policy officials say, this is what's really happening, and yet I'm still pursuing this. That tells me there is a strategy, there is a direction, and there is an agenda. I obviously may not care for that. That's neither here nor there. But I think it does indicate that to suggest that there is nothing there, they're just reacting at anything, I think is probably wrong. So where do we go from here? And I think one of the problems is that we tend to name doctrines after presidents. And so if you like George W. Bush, you're okay with the Bush Doctrine. But if you don't like George W. Bush, then you're not okay with the Bush Doctrine. Now, pause there for a second, and I've done this exercise with some groups in the past. I sometimes hand out like a slip and I say, do you like the idea that America should be military primacy, engage in military primacy, that we should be the only superior military. Do you think America should stand for engaging the world over human rights and democracy and ensuring that if things go completely awry, we're even willing to use hard power to save people's lives if that becomes necessary from things such as genocide? And do you think that before a state acts, if there are a threat on the horizon, that we should act? And do you think if a state is right at our door ready to act, that we should act? And almost whether I'm talking to a Rotarian crowd, a college crowd, or a crowd like this, invariably the vast majority of people say yes. If I notice Bush's name, I might get 60% less. So that's problem one, that by associating names, whether it's James K. Polk, whether it's Truman, whether it's Reagan, whether it's Carter, whether it's Bush, we're not willing to deal with the doctrine on its own. And that should be the first thing. So maybe I've talked about, I wrote a piece, this also might have been for the Times, I don't remember anymore, called The American Doctrine. What if we called it an American Doctrine? If we rooted some of these core values of both liberal principles and realist principles into one and called it an American Doctrine, well, how would the electorate react? I think it's a great experiment to try. But I think that it is a problem until we can overcome the bias of the name. And I think one of the problems that we're facing today, aside from the original one I talked about regarding to counterterrorism, is we hope that our candidates need to address this, because at the end of the day, it doesn't really matter their stances on healthcare, taxes, education, Social Security. I was speaking to a larger group 2 weeks ago, and they said, well, what do you mean? What about jobs? What about healthcare? I said, well, you know, jobs. I don't know, the president in the plum book, was that about 200 jobs, 300 jobs he might control? Otherwise, he goes to Congress. We call it Obamacare, but that's just silliness. It was the Congress who passed that law. So whether you want a 1 cent national gas tax, or whether you want to cut capital gains, or whether you want to nationalize education system, or you want to abolish the Secretary of Education, at the end of the day, almost all of those decisions will be up to whatever Congress is around. Now, he can bomb Damascus tomorrow. One of the common questions I get, and I'll just preempt it now, who should I vote for? I don't know why they're asking me. Somebody thinks I know the answer to that. I don't want to say, oh, you should vote for this candidate or that. So what I say is this, and I believe this in a heartfelt way. I do not think you should ever vote for a president about jobs or education or healthcare or taxes or business regulations, because again, at the end of the day, they have no power. Oh, they can sit up in a speech and say, I think Congress should do this. Vote for the man or the woman that on day one of the inauguration finds out that Putin decides that he wants the rest of Ukraine. And he has to deal, or she has to deal with that. And if you are comfortable that that man or woman on day one of the inauguration could deal with that crisis, then that's who you should vote for. And on that note, I'm happy to take questions.
First of all, I'm not going to be anywhere near as eloquent as you are, but just a little bit about myself. Spent 25 years in the military, worked at the Pentagon, drafted strategy and policy, ran for U.S. Congress with the hopes to win an election and serve on the armed services or maybe an intel committee. And, you know, one of the things I often talk about is that president is just one person. Mm-hmm. So unless you have a very effective, congenial Congress, mm-hmm. you just can't get the job done in our nation's best interest. So, I don't know. What are your thoughts? I mean, yes, who do you select for president? It's more so, who are you going to select as your state representative? And are they going to do things in a bipartisan fashion to help the president execute the policy or the legislation?
Yeah, I mean, I think if, again, if you're talking about a lot of those domestic issues, that's extremely important. The idea that any president should have relationships with the other party, whatever party that is, I mean, it's critical. I mean, look at the successful presidents that we've had. Successful presidents on the domestic side have been those that said, well, okay, I might not get 100% of my agenda here. I'm talking again about domestic legislation, domestic programs. Maybe I'll get 60, 70, or 80, and I have to give up some things, and I'm willing to build these relationships. And if it's a Democratic president, you would hope they would do that with a Republican Congress. On the other hand, I think in the area of national security and foreign policy, it's really the president. It is the president's show. He needs to make sure that he has an appointed governmental officials that follow his or her lead. But the decisions come out of the White House. I mean, whether we're talking about that, you know, we talk a lot of, everybody was talking when Biden was still potentially running, what did he really say about bin Laden? You know, but at the end of the day, it was the president's decision whether or not to do that or not. And he doesn't have to go to Congress for that. And if he wanted to bypass his entire cabinet, he could if he felt like it. So I think you're right. I mean, if you're voting for who is going to be able to work with everyone for that domestic agenda, I think that's really critical. But to me, because Article 2 vests the American president with such amazing and overriding power related to diplomacy, military affairs, geopolitics, that you are voting primarily for that person and not for anything else. And I think, sure.
In DOD, you have the QDR.
Mm-hmm, right.
QDDR, but then you look how big the NSD is right now.
Right. And different presidents have played with those numbers. I mean, you know, and then for a while there was a more formalized process that was streamlined by George Herbert Walker Bush. But if, you know, I think we've seen presidents, and it becomes very clear, I think, when they're running for office, who clearly view foreign policy and national security as an annoyance. I want to get back to fill-in-the-blank domestic plan. And I think I would think that we, as both citizens and as people who want to influence others, that needs to stop. If I will not name names, but there are definitely candidates in both parties that simply, you can tell, this is just not their thing. They don't get it. They don't want to get it. And they think, you know what, I'll have a staff to deal with it. I'll have a Secretary of State to deal with it. I'll have a Secretary of Defense and a CIA director to deal with it. But that never works. Many of you may know Jim Woolsey, and you know, some of you know this joke that he never really could get a one-on-one meeting with Bill Clinton. I think he told me that he once got a meeting, but Lake was kind of standing in the shadows, and it was just impossible for them to sit down one-on-one. And then there was that guy who crashed the Cessna 152 or 172, and they said, "Is that Jim Woolsey trying to get in to see the president?" That's just sad. It's also sad that Jim told me that he found out about Task Force Ranger in Somalia from CNN. So I have that footnote in my book in case you think I made that up. But yeah, Mike.
Dr. Colucci, first, thank you for your candid and very well thought out presentation. I know that I and probably everyone.
There's a good Wisconsin contingent in here.
That's right. We all found it very, very informative. Now, yesterday, we had what, to my eye, was a historic hearing on Capitol Hill, where the former Secretary of State was called to testify to answer questions both about Benghazi, as well as the separate question, but somewhat interrelated, with the computer server within her own home while she was Secretary of State, which she used to conduct apparently the foreign policy of our country. And I'm at a little bit of a disadvantage. I try to read in the media, that's my source of information, and I try to figure out what happened at Benghazi. What is it? I know that some of the parents of the deceased soldiers have been quoted in the media as feeling very strongly that there was negligence at best and something else at worst. And I wonder what your take on what happened in Benghazi. I know this is off topic. Hmm. You're here, and I'm here, and here we are. And what's your take on what happened in Benghazi? And what's your take on how having a computer server, which I'm also a disadvantage, I don't know anything about computers, how having a computer server at home to conduct foreign affairs with could impact or impinge national security?
Well, for those of you who don't know, the real famous person in the room is Justice Michael Gableman of the Wisconsin Supreme Court. So he's much more famous than I am.
I get to go watch this.
I'm not going to pretend to know what went what exactly all happened in Benghazi, but I don't want to dodge the question, because then I'll answer it this way. I feel that the questions are, they're not the right questions in this sense. The initial attack happens, and communication goes and says this attack is happening. And the real question that is answered 7,000 different ways by both DOD, State, Secretary Clinton, Mike Morrell, is could there have been assets, American response, that would have saved lives, intervened, or at worst, immediately gone after the people who conducted the attacks, even if they couldn't have been saved. I don't, for some reason, see the committee focusing enough attention on that. I also don't see Secretary Clinton addressing that. And that bothers me probably more than anything else. There is very little reason to believe that that part of it could not have been done much better. Now, this movie that's coming out, which I haven't seen, I gather suggests, and through interviewing of the soldiers, they've built this movie, especially many of the special operators, so you know, one would assume that there's a level of honesty, although I realize it's a movie production, suggests that that was where everything went wrong. And if that's true, that's the real story. And I'll relate it to something. Many of you probably, this is silly to say this, many of you remember the Monica Lewinsky business. Why am I bringing that up? Because it was such the sideshow to what was going on with President Clinton's administration relationship to China, especially over technology. Now, Senator Fred Thompson, long before he ever thought about running for president, attempted to investigate this and put this outside in the most transparent fashion, but no one seemed to care. No party, no group really seemed to care. And it's all, so the question I always ask, you know, where's the sideshow and where's the reality? And as much as, you know, and as far as the email situation, again, I'm not an IT expert. Oh, I've talked to many in the field, by the way, about this, and you know, they laugh. I mean, they laugh about the initial excuses related to the IRS, as well as the initial excuses here about retrieval. All the IT people I know who work for big corporations just laugh, and they say, yeah, sure. So, I mean, there's that part of it, and I can share that. But you know, the first reaction I had, Mike, was the Chinese MSS, Ministry of State Security, and the Russian SVR, and this has now been said by many other people other than me, were in and out of that with everything they could get. And that's the real question. So forget the partisanship and whether or not you love Hillary Clinton or hate Hillary Clinton. The question one has to ask, and just base it on national security issues objectively, why would the Secretary of State handle any sensitive information, potentially classified as the FBI investigation seems to already have dabbled in? Why would she do that? I don't have the answer to that, but one has to ask. Again, people say, well, Barack Obama doesn't have a strategy, but he's an intelligent man. Hillary Clinton's an intelligent woman. You have to ask why, and I don't know. But it does strain credulity, as
you
they say.
You started your comments, so yeah. You don't mind following, and this, I'll shut up. You started your comments by saying it didn't get a lot of attention at the hearing. And I wonder, you know, here we are. You know, it seems to me that between the two of us, without having rehearsed it, have kind of put our finger on two of the larger, more important issues. Why do you suppose? Can you think of any? I mean, they're not stupid. They're not all stupid. And why haven't they focused in on those questions?
Because I think that some of the people advising them, I assume, are involved in domestic politics and election politics. And I think just as I think when they looked at Lewinsky and just as when they look at Benghazi, okay, well, what do they think the people understand? Well, the people will understand dead Americans. They want to get into response time and rapid response teams and things like that. I'm not saying that's true. I'm saying that there potentially could be those kind of advisors. You know, the people will understand Monica Lewinsky, or they'll understand these, and what almost always is a sideshow. I mean, you want me to throw another bombshell out? WMD in Iraq. Well, the people will understand that. They're not necessarily, you know, they're not going to necessarily understand the horrible nature of Saddam and his expansionist goals, and he's allowing these terrorists to be trained in his country, and so let's just focus on WMD, and then something might backfire. And I actually think that the electorate can handle information at a much higher level. I think that, you know, I mean, you and I are from Wisconsin, where real people live, and if the average person in our state, if you're honest with them and direct with them, and you try to explain the importance of these issues, they will listen to you. They will listen to you about military issues, and they'll listen to you about national security issues. But I think there's an attitude in kind of the New York, Boston, Washington kind of theory, well, the people, they don't understand this stuff. Let's just focus on, you know, in this sense, dead Americans. And don't get the impression I'm denigrating those deaths. That is definitively opposite of my point. I'm making the point that there are dead Americans. That's an unbelievable tragedy. That needs to be addressed. But there's an overarching issue here of why were they dead? And worse, and I think one of the congressmen or congresswomen yesterday tried to get to this, was it maybe the fellow from Ohio, I think. You could correct me, one of you could correct me. Was it Shepard who said, isn't this really about the fact that your gold stone in national security foreign policy was Libya, that fell apart and you couldn't come to terms with it? I wish he would have gone after that for 20 minutes. Because that really is the issue here. The policy was a total failure. It made no sense from beginning to end. People immediately before that warned not to do it because of what would happen in that country. And then when everything goes from bad to worse, and the Benghazi issue is the worst, and now we have the next stage of worse, which is total chaos, and ISIS now in control of at least one port city in Libya, how do you possibly then defend the policy? That would have made more sense. And I think Shepard, I think that's the right one. I think he tried that, and then it kind of just went off. But yeah, thank you. Yeah, you first.
I'd like to take you back to the top of your thing, grand strategy.
Yeah, yeah.
You talked about earlier on grand strategy, operations, key defenses, tactics. You said that latter is reversed, and I agree. Mm-hmm. Director Mueller, the former FBI director, said that in his view, America needs to become more acceptable of disasters. And I know that's hard. He didn't say that while he was in. He said that in speeches after he retired. How do you make that switch? Because you referenced the American public was the easy one to get that point across to. Well, I just don't see it. I wish we could make that flip. And I was wondering if you have any insight on how you think, A, the government needs to do that, maybe the polity as well.
Well, yeah, so you're asking, you know, can we translate this for the public to think it's important?
You
is that?
I want my president dealing with how to pull triggers. I want
right.
him to deal in big size.
Yeah, yeah. Well, you're right. I mean, I think candidates, I mean, should be forced to address where they think this country should be geopolitically in 50 years. And by the way, you know, I'm using terms. It doesn't mean you'd use those terms exactly. I mean, I realize that there has to be a translation of different terminology for the electorate. It's not because of they're less intelligent, but that they deal with things at a different stage. But the press and the debate, the moderators should be asking these questions. How do you ensure America is going to still be in its preeminent position? And why is that important? Now, on the flip side, if I'm a candidate, I can really go far with this. Because if I have that vision and I'm able to communicate that to people in a language that they will respond to, and it doesn't have to be, quote, dumb language, it just needs to be clear and direct without all kinds of circuitous motions. But if I can translate that, I will get the benefit of that because I think people do care. I mean, give an example from my home state of Wisconsin. There's a border city called Beloit, and some of you from Wisconsin know that city well. And it is a Democratic bastion. And so what happens is Republican candidates essentially avoid it like the plague. And there was this interesting, this was in the late 80s, early 90s, and there was this idea that why aren't, in this case, Republican candidates willing to talk about missile defense in Beloit? Is it because you don't think those people want to be protected in the same way people from Boston do? Of course not. But it's that unwillingness to even think in those terms, And whatever you think about missile defense is really not my point. My point is that why aren't we going to people and explaining, you know, there are these threats, and these threats have a greater impact on you potentially than any domestic program going one way or the other. But we don't. Now, part of it is, you know, people like us in this room, you know, foreign policy experts, national security experts, people involved in this stuff, you know, how often do we want to reach out to the non-academic, non-practitioner policy people? I do half of my talks to groups like Lions and Rotary and Kiwanis, and yeah, it doesn't mean I don't necessarily always use the same language, but I use the same concepts. And I find that people are intensely interested. And I'm not selling anything here to any of you. I didn't even bring books to sell. So, but I can guarantee you they are. They're like, what, really? Why is that? That really could affect me that way? How is that? What's going to happen with my son or daughter if there's a problem? And so it's an easy one. I think it just takes candidates on one end, and it takes us and the media on the other to say, how do we engage the public more? Because there's a danger, by the way, that all of us in the room, regardless if you're Republican, Democrat, liberal, libertarian, or conservative, that is, the more rarefied and insulated the world of foreign affairs and national security is, the more the general public will feel that the only real answer is an isolationism of some kind. It is, that's for these experts, but they've, quote, screwed everything up. So maybe the answer is, let's just not deal with the world because it doesn't make sense and no one's talking to me about it. So I think it's critical, yeah.
Thank you, Professor. Armin Salak, and graduate from Johns Hopkins. Thank you for the talk.
Thank you.
If I may bring the idea of sort of to piggyback a little bit on the idea of grand strategy and how that may relate to other powers. So we usually hear about grand strategy of Russia or the US or China, but it's rarely talked about for middle power or even smaller powers. So I wanted to maybe ask you, what's your take? How does the idea of grand strategy relate to medium or small powers? Is it any different? And does it even make any sense for, say, a small power to even have a grand strategy?
Sure. Interesting question. I wrote a piece a year ago for World Affairs called Great Power Conflict is Not Dead. And in it, I talked about the grand strategy of Russia, Japan, India, China, and Russia. And I think, probably preaching to the choir at this particular institution, but in general, the academy, International Relations Academy writ large in Europe and the United States, does believe great power conflict is dead. And so there's a disconnect that's pretty large, huge, in fact. But I think for medium and small powers, it essentially becomes a choice of, do you want to be caught up in a whirlwind of one of these other grand strategies, or do you want to try to join? And I think that's very critical for the United States, because obviously the choice of many medium and small powers is to hitch their wagon to the United States. And I think that's very important for U.S. foreign policy to ensure that those allies that are medium and small powers are protected and dealt with in a way that is necessary and is respectful. And I worry, for example, among many, we could talk about many examples here, but I think that one of the problems of the last 8 years essentially has been ignoring Europe in general. I mean, there's some lip service about the European Union and things like this, but in order to ensure that you have healthy relationships with all of the European nations, whether they're the so-called larger powers like Great Britain, all the way on down to Slovakia and the Czech Republic and everything else, that you need to not only build that relationship, but you have to be credible when it comes to promises. And you know, a particular interest of mine, and I'm sure a number of you in this room, is NATO. And you know, we have decided that states, whether it be in the Baltic states or Eastern Europe, are part of NATO. Well, that means that's it. It's over with. The debate's finished. And you have to make sure that you are as credible to them in their defense, so that their grand strategy essentially, therefore, is they're now linked to American grand strategy. And that means that they could sacrifice for that, and you can't allow that. I suppose that's the unfortunate aspect, that I suppose the medium and small power states have to essentially choose to be on board with one of the other great powers in grand strategy. And for American grand strategy to work, the currency is going to have to be credibility in its promises. And that's a big concern.
Professor, I have a question. You mentioned two of the important pillars of American foreign policy and doctrine, which began with Washington. And I was thinking in particular about the freedom of navigation of the seas. Mm-hmm. In particular that one. And I was just thinking that I feel like that policy in particular, I'm not sure how much it's a quintessentially American idea. I feel like it was borrowed from Great Britain, mm-hmm. Just as much as the idea of free trade. And I just wanted, now obviously Great Britain is a much diminished power, but with regards to what similarities and differences do you see between, the policy of the old British Empire mm-hmm. and the United States today, and which would you say has been more effective in general as a foreign policy, maybe in those years?
Sure. I mean, the three stages of when we've had situations like this, whether it's the Pax Romana, the Pax Britannicus, or the Pax Americana, obviously we in that third stage built upon the other two, borrowing more from the British, obviously, than the Romans, although there's aspects of even Roman grand strategy that America continues in this concept of culture, language, rule of law, things of that nature. The British definitively attempted to enforce British foreign policy through navigation of the seas, but that was primarily a mercantilist approach. It'll be the Americans that fully embrace the concept of free navigation of the seas for free trade, which now, of course, has been mutated, depending on your viewpoint, good or ill, into globalization. I think the British also used ideas of, Roosevelt's non-politically correct term these days of civilizing, but the British still probably would have used that term, the concept of bringing in ideas of civil society, rule of law, cultural attitudes about government, bureaucracy, anti-corruption. But it is the United States that avoids that British sentiment of automatic superiority. Americans might be accused of the so-called ugly American of the Graham Greene novel, but it wasn't because of the sense that Americans are inherently better. It is probably the idea that American values are inherently better, and I think that's a big difference. The British, they're just better because they're British, right? I mean, that's their view. Many of my friends are British, and I did my doctorate there, so I think I can beat up on them a little bit. And I'm a huge cheerleader for the Anglo-American relationship as the single most important foreign policy alliance. But having said that, there is still a sentiment of British being British. But it's, for us, it wasn't Americans being Americans, it's American values. And some people are uncomfortable with that.
But as a quick follow-up,
sure.
I would say that, I personally feel that the linchpin of British foreign policy for the majority of its status as a great power was, an inheritance of pragmatism, which I think is, lacking. And, the American mm-hmm. values, you said, there's an appreciation of, instilling democratic values, and we can see the criticism, for example, with Britain engaging with China just recently, without really talking about human rights very much. But would you, I feel like a lot of, for example, the American wars and intervention abroad have been sort of mixed successes and mixed failures. Korea, for example, we didn't end up with a complete victory. Vietnam, we backed out. Whereas I would argue that, British foreign policy, at least, during the 18th century and so on, which was much more based mm-hmm. on pragmatism, was perhaps more successful. I mean, they were able to sort of contain
sure.
and control the world better. Would you say that's because of a more complex world, or just that, how would you?
Well, I mean, the British foreign policy under men like Castlereagh attempted to, during and right after the Napoleonic Wars, thought that they could maintain a balance of power. And it becomes expressed in many different interventions one way or the other. So in the Crimean War, they decide that they'll side with the Turks because they fear that an overriding Russia will be even worse. What did that give them? So I think Britain dug its own grave in many ways, because you can play that game, as I would argue, for the short term, and you might be able to get yourself 50, even 100 years. But I'm not interested in that. I'm interested in something that goes well beyond 50 or 100 years for this country. I want to see a grand strategy followed and implemented that ensures American preeminence long into anybody's vision. And so, you know, Jim Woolsey, and I bring Jim up a lot. I like Jim, and he's a friend of mine, and he has these wonderful quotes. But the one thing, I remember him saying, and he might have said it in many venues, but he said, at what point are we going to stop using the Middle East as a filling station? That's not a policy. That's not a strategy. A strategy is ensuring that American values, not just American strategic interests, are inherently bound up inside the Middle East. And so that British pragmatic policy, except over slavery, where they went a different direction with people like Wilberforce, but that British policy of balance of power and pragmatism, I think, worked for a period of time. But it was doomed to failure because it cannot, by its very nature, be consistent beyond the fact that you're wedded to that balance of power. I think for me, the question has to be, for what goal? Do we want to see a better world that's more stable, that has more democracies, that has more respect for human rights, that has less genocide and less atrocities, that will gain real stability? Or do we want to gain 10 or 20 years? You know, I mean, the United States could have easily installed some secondary strongman in Iraq. It would have been an easier policy. He could have been quote-unquote pro-American in the sense that he would have followed kind of American strategic interests. He would have been less worse than Uday, Qusay, or Saddam. And then what? That buys us 10, 20, 30 years. Now, some of you think, especially given some of your age, that's a long time. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about, how do we ensure that America does not follow in Britain's or Rome's footsteps? That's actually my, I guess, if I had never, I never really said it out loud, but I suppose that's my real goal. I don't want to follow Rome or Britain's footsteps in this. I don't want to believe in the inevitability of the decline. I mean, there's no reason to believe, because we are so fundamentally different. So I think there's great things to learn from that Metternich, Castlereagh, Talleyrand style. I'm not saying you ignore that, and there are times where those tools can be necessary. I'm not sure that there's a lasting, though, ability for that. Yeah.
You mentioned something that I agree with, that most people are and have very interested and have the capacity to understand can the explanations of foreign policy. But how do you explain the leading candidate for, I think, 100 years now, 100 days now, in the polls is notorious for buzzwords and overgeneralization and explanations that fit into 140 characters?
Now, you're talking about Bernie Sanders, right? No. How many pairs of underwear? You're basically asking what I think of the Trump phenomenon, right? I mean, isn't that, or am I missing kind of where your thrust is going?
Even though people are interested in and are receptive to complex explanations of foreign policy, he is still popular with his buzzwords and phrases.
I think, in my opinion, there's two answers to that. First, because the other candidates are not bringing it into the table, right? I mean, you got Jeb Bush doing a little bit of it, and Marco Rubio doing a little bit of it. I think Cruz is a little bit as well. I don't see Sanders is off the field on foreign affairs. I mean, there's a few statements that you can see. Not even much, really, from Hillary Clinton, and Chafee actually probably had the most to say about it, and he got out today. And Webb, but that didn't last either. So, but it wasn't because of foreign policy. It's because the main candidates are not highlighting it. So there's a vacuum. I think that's part one. Part two, I mean, I think it deals with some of the phenomena with people like Trump. I mean, it's now become so cliche. I imagine all of you are have heard it a million times, that the pundit class got it wrong. They all predicted that Trump would implode yesterday, the day before, the month before, and he didn't. And I remember, you know, when it all happened, I just turned to some people and said, you know, I don't know, but I think people are probably just so incredibly frustrated. And I don't think it's about foreign policy. I think they're frustrated with the inability for many of the candidates, the perception at least, to give them straight and direct answers. And I think that would relate to foreign affairs. I mean, you look at the last Democratic debate on the issue of how often did foreign policy and national security come up? About 20%. There were three mentions of the word terrorism in the entire evening. Al-Qaeda was not mentioned. If it was mentioned, maybe once. It was either zero or once. And the question one has to ask ourselves is that Anderson Cooper and company's fault? Maybe. I don't know. Maybe they don't find it interesting. Maybe they didn't think it was appropriate that evening. I've heard someone say, well, the later debates will focus more on national security. Maybe. I don't know. The other part is the candidates themselves. I mean, when asked to answer questions, they kept wanting to pivot into kind of what they probably consider their main strengths, tend to be social policy and economic policy. So I think they're partially to blame. So I don't think people are responding to Trump because he's avoiding foreign policy. I think they're responding to Trump because he talks to them very directly, very honestly, bluntly, maybe even rudely for some people's taste. But also that the main candidates of both parties aren't really highlighting national security and foreign policy. And that'll be to their detriment in the end, because as things winnow out and that becomes ever more important, and the situation in Syria will get worse before it gets better, as an example. And so whoever is the Democratic nominee and whoever is the Republican nominee, you can bet that when those initial general election debates hit, how do you plan to handle Syria? Exactly. Not, you know, boilerplate, there'll be a coalition and our Arab allies will help us out and, you know, we're going to give more money for the refugees. I mean, this is what passes for strategies for some of the campaigns. But way in the back, yeah.
Yes, I'm Juliet Addington. I would like to hear your perspective on Steven Pinker, who said that violence, global violence, is decreasing. And do you think that's influencing the attitude of the U.S. towards global challenges, especially Al-Qaeda, that is a transformation into ISIS? Where did you see? Where are we in this violence?
I think I've heard of the theory, and it's not the first time. I guess I don't want to make light of it, but it's kind of like a dear friend of mine was the old senior labor economist for the state of Wisconsin. Now he's replaced by three people, but that's government for you. But. He used to say, you know, unemployment in Wisconsin, you know, at this particular year was, you know, whatever, 5.4%. And then he would add, but you know, it's 100% for the guy unemployed. And so whether violence is down or up, I'll leave that to my quantitativist colleagues and their voodoo magic that seems to, you know, prove different statistics. But I can tell you that for the people who are on the other side of the bayonet, it's 100%. And that's the people in places like Syria and Iraq. And Ukraine. So I think the question really is why hasn't the United States provided a sound strategic policy for these places? I mean, if you want to get out, then okay, then get out and justify it and be done. But if you want to stop it and you're serious about stopping it, then you're going to have to use violent means. And the way to protect American troops, and this goes back to my American way of war, which really develops in its fullness under Lincoln and the Union generals in particular, as they painfully learn some very bad lessons, is overwhelming force, overwhelming firepower, a lot more than you ever imagined you would need, and get it over very quickly. And then have a plan for once it's over with, which will probably be occupation. And that occupation has to be very measured and very detailed, and it will probably last longer than anybody really wants to hear about. Now, or maybe you don't get involved, but this American fairly recent phenomenon, when I say recent, you know, for me recent could be 50 to 75 years, of where kind of have a hybrid. We're a light footprint, maybe medium footprint, and then maybe stay a little bit, but not too long, and it just never works. Yet we continue to think that maybe this model, and I have to believe that it goes back to what we keep talking. We've talked a lot about the electorate. I think the electorate will do it. The electorate will support you if you're honest with them and you tell them why. And you speak to them and say, you know, George W. Bush, and again, I bring him up, and yeah, I think he's a great president, and nobody tried to burn me yet or tar and feather me, but he was honest with us. I don't know if anybody remembers this, but he was once asked, it was his first term after 9/11, I could look it up, 2002 or 3, I don't remember. And they said, President Bush, somebody in the media, how long do you think this is going to last? And if any of you remember this, President Bush paused and he said, I can't give you a specific date, but I'd be lying if I said less than 40 years. How many of you remember that? He said it. He was honest with us. And he was right. So what should have been done from that moment onward, and I don't think the Bush administration did this very well, and I don't think the Obama administration wanted to get into it, is that should have been reinforced. 40 years if we're lucky. 40 years. It doesn't mean 40 years in Iraq. It doesn't mean 40 years of constant warfare. That's not what anybody said. But as far as trying to deal with this new international relations environment of international, transnational rogue states, weapons of mass destruction, which is not just nuclear weapons, it's not just the weapons themselves, it's everything in the chain of engineering it and making it, moving it and creating it, and rogue states such as Iran and the former Iraq and North Korea, when you get that nexus together, which is the new international environment, and trying to deal with that, that's probably, I mean, 40 years, I guess, you're lucky maybe if it's 40 years. But I think the people would respect someone who initially would say that, not who would say, oh, I think this will be quick, and then backtracks, and then says, you know, the boys will be home by Christmas, didn't work out in the Second World War, and it almost cost us the war, the support for the war. People forget this, and what happened in 44 and in early 45. And luckily things turned around, but sorry, yeah.
Professor Colucci, I'm John Lachowski from IWP. I'm sorry I missed some of the guts of your talk, but having heard the last part of what you had to say, I wanted to ask you if it is possible for us to have some kind of a policy that balances our desire to try to create democracy and sort of a world order of free trade and rule of law and decent behavior without getting into the nation building business, which I sense the American people feel is fine if they think that it can be done in the short term, but if it goes anything longer than a couple of years, it becomes intolerable. I mean, we fought a 20-year democracy-building counterinsurgency war in Nicaragua from about 1915 to 1934, and a similar 20-year war in Haiti from 1914 mm-hmm. to 1934. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And we did all of the hearts and minds stuff. We did all of the democratization stuff. And finally, we got so frustrated with this, because ultimately there were people who didn't want us there, that we washed our hands of both places. We installed a dictator in each place, right, so that there would be order.
Right.
And it makes me wonder. I mean, I was involved in helping set up the National Endowment for Democracy, so I'm very sympathetic to these values. But I think that our attempts to go against the grain of culture in Iraq and Afghanistan, yep, are repetitions of the Haitian and the Nicaraguan models. And I just don't think the American people, yep, will tolerate it for any more than a short time, so long as success continues.
Yeah. No, I think you're right in this sense. And maybe when you may have heard this or not. So the strain of thought that some call democratic globalists was not what the Bush people were about. They've been called, I mean, I use this term crusading realist or democratic realism. And in that sense, you need to be very careful about which places you choose to try to do this. And it was desired, and it was also seen that Iraq could potentially be that, but not Afghanistan. So in Afghanistan, the idea is you need to establish order after you clean out the Al-Qaeda and the Taliban. And in Iraq, once you get rid of the Ba'athists, then you have a chance of building an Arab, Muslim, democratic system on their cultural terms, only through that very painful process. But it would require first the establishment of order. I mean, and you know, you can talk about General Newbold's plan of 385,000 troops. If that would have been followed, where would we be today? I think we'd be in a much different place than when we ultimately decided to do this and then reduce forces and then, you know, the decisions with the Iraqi army and so forth. So, you know, what did Roosevelt say about Somoza? He might be a son of a bitch, but he's our son of a bitch. And in a place like Nicaragua, the early 20th century, or in Haiti, maybe forever, no, they're not anywhere near ready for that. And so, yeah, order is going to be the only possible choice versus any worse option, which would be chaos, terrorism, spillover of violence, and everything else. On the other hand, I think what many of the Bush people argue, and I assume if they were here, they would continue to argue it, I don't know, is that if you're really looking to solve the problem of Islamic extremism, you're never going to be able to kill all the terrorists, even their leaders. And you're never going to build enough schools and water treatment facilities and roads, because even if you build the schools, they're likely to behead the teacher when you leave. So the whole bullets and books debate, I think, is a false one, because it's not going to fly for the long term. So then the question is, well, then what can be the grand strategy? What can be the strategy to deal with Islamic extremism? If you can't kill all the extremists that want to do you harm, and you really don't have the ability to engage in this massive New Deal for the Middle East, aside from the enormous costs that we wouldn't want to incur, there's a question of could it be sustainable without the military force to back it up, then is there an answer? And I think the answer was, is it possible that you give an alternative? Is there a way that if you help to build an Arab Islamic democracy in a place like Iraq, which is different than trying it in definitively Israel, but even Turkey, it has to be in an Arab-dominated, Islamic-dominated country, then do you give that, is that alternative therefore created? And I think it has to have, that's why I think it's realist in its concept. And you're not going to do that in a place like Haiti, I think. I mean, I'm not a Haitian expert by any stretch of the imagination, but my limited knowledge of the period you're talking about, and then with the Duvalier era, and then after that with the unbelievable events following, I don't see it in our lifetime. No. So I think you're right. So the question is, how do we formulate a strategy for those places that could be recipients of that kind of American help? And it has to be done on their terms too. And that's why, you know, I'm going farther than afield on this question than maybe I should, but I mean, Maliki was a bad move. But I think precisely because the United States allowed things to become so off the rails that you end up allowing a Maliki to take power. Maybe you don't. Maybe you have a situation where you first lock down the country with the hard power tools, and then you might introduce those things. So, yeah, sorry, I think I...
It sounds to me like you are arguing that a basic assumption of U.S. grand strategy should be that we should assume a moral responsibility for improving the rest of the world. And okay. Yeah, that's where you're. That's okay. Now, if you
just, if that's a little too general, but okay, go ahead.
I mean, it sounds like that's what you've been arguing, so you could, you know, elucidate your.
Sure.
Point,
sure.
Okay, but the point is that if that is the center point assumption of your grand strategy, then you have a goal that flows out of that. Because that was your argument, that we've got to have goals. Where are you going to get the money to reach those goals? And are you so sure that that is our responsibility?
Yeah, right. Okay.
I have raised doubts that should be an assumption of our grand strategy.
Yeah. Well, I'm as I said, I'm not a democratic globalist. That, you know, it's everywhere all the time, and it, by any stretch of the imagination. However, I think that if you want to build the consensus between liberalism and realism, the way to do that is to prove to the realist that if you really want stability, you're going to have to base it on morality. And if you want to actually have the protection of human rights and you want to combat things of genocide and atrocities, then you're going to have to use hard power. So the liberals are allergic to, again, I'm talking these terms of international relations terms, the liberals seem to be almost allergic to the use of hard power and covert operations and maybe being a little bit loose with certain elections when they are corrupt and so forth. And the realists, you know, well, where's the cold calculation of national and vital interests? But my argument is that if you really are interested in that cold calculation of vital and national interests, it has to be long-term. And long-term is not supporting Somoza, and it's not supporting the House of Saud. The House of Saud's days are numbered. I will guarantee you this. And I might eat my tie, but I'm willing to come back in 25 years and eat this tie if you want. The House of Saud is numbered. So the question for the United States is, it's not going to go tomorrow, but if I'm right, premise, that the House of Saud's days are numbered, then where do we want to be on that equation? Now, we can let the Islamic extremists take over the country. That can easily happen. We can let the country get into some bifurcated mess, which would benefit the Iranians again, or we can be part of that transition out and ensure that there is a Saudi Arabian version of civil society and democracy and human rights that both they and we can buy into. I do think that is long-term stability. So my argument is that I'm trying, if you want to appeal to both the liberal side of the aisle that says I'm for human rights and democracy and toleration and rule of law, and you want to appeal to the realist that says, well, I want order and stability, and we have to have a system that allows for things of trade and commerce and relations between states to be somewhat normal. If you really want that, there has to be something more than buying into a 10 or 20 year fix. On the moral question, do I believe that the United States bears a responsibility when the worst aspects of the human condition erupt? Yes. Yeah, as a Christian, I believe that I cannot let my country stand by when things such as genocide occur. That's true. And since I believe the United States has a different moral obligation, then I do believe we have that moral obligation. Yeah.
Is there any other thing that we have a moral obligation to do?
Sure.
Moral. That was a strong point of yours. I'm just exploring this aspect of it, the moral obligation as an assumption.
Yes. Well, I think that if the only nation that can prevent the worst aspects that humanity has to offer is the United States, and there is no coalition because no one is willing to do it, and they usually aren't, even maybe the British, maybe not. And whether it's the issue of Sudan and Darfur, which President Bush and Tony Blair were on the same page and nobody else was, or whether it's intervening long ago in Syria, long before ISIS reared its ugly head in 2012, 2011, whether it's the Green Revolution in Iran, where the United States should have been at the forefront of that instead of entirely backing off and giving carte blanche to the Ayatollahs, that if we are the only ones, then yes, I think that as the country given such immense power, there's only us. And, you know, whether you want to look at a light in the darkness and that's the only us, I think that that has to be our responsibility. It justifies the material and earthly power and wealth that we've been blessed with. Yeah, sure. Sure.
I just wanted to thank you, Professor.
Thank you.
For a tremendous
thank you very much. Appreciate it. Yeah, thank you.